Hey, good afternoon, everybody. John Logier here. I'm welcoming you to today's seminar on the John and Mary Louise Riley seminar series that we hosted at Bodega Marine Lab as part of the UC Davis Coastal Marine Sciences Institute. We welcome Michael Koohafkan today giving the seminar, which double bills as a seminar and also as the next seminar, because Michael's finishing up his PhD. The full seminar series is, this is the first in the full seminar series, so you hopefully are aware that there are a bunch of other seminars coming up next week. We have Lauren Salan, who's an assistant professor, University of Pennsylvania, talking about the rise and fall of fishes, macroevolution and mass extinction in early vertebrates. Beyond that, we're going to shortly go to Michael and let him give the seminar. As I said to those of you online a few minutes ago, there being a Zoom webinar, there's no chat button, but there is a Q&A button that you should find on your screen. And that's primarily for questions that I will pose to Michael later on, your questions I'll read there. But also if there's something happening during the seminar that you want to bring to my attention as the host, or if there's something that's really a critical clarification, feel free to put it up there. I'll watch for those as well. Michael will talk for 45 minutes, let's say. Leave us about 10 minutes. No longer, Michael. No. Leave us 10 minutes or so for some questions. And of course, plenty of time for you to follow up with Michael at a later date. He loves to talk about his research, and it's sure interesting enough. So Michael's kind of a local kid made good. He's from this region and started his academic career at Humboldt State, where he did environmental resources engineering, 2011 maybe, something like that, a decade ago. And lots of time, lots of learning, and lots of experiences in between. But prior to coming to Davis, he did a master's in civil and environmental at Berkeley, and then started at Davis in late 2014, where he joined the Hydrologic Sciences Graduate Group, and it's specifically the Coastal Oceanography Group. So in the early days, Michael and I worked together and others in our group on Russian River Estuary. And then he sort of wandered a little bit into some rivers which have no salt in them. So half his thesis some of it will be on the Russian River and some of it will be on the Missouri River. There's a common theme of patches of habitat and sandbanks and sandbars. So his work is strongly motivated by ecological interests, but what has really brought to it is some innovative application of quantitative methods, which I think has advanced our thinking in both contexts. During his graduate career, Michael worked at the Army Corps of Engineer Hydrologic Engineering Center in Davis. And in 2018, he started working full-time while finishing his PhD. Hopefully you didn't run too short of sleep, Michael, but he's been at the Department of Water Resources since 2018, so it's almost 2 years now, and is a professional engineer now as well. So that's probably enough for me to say. I think you're going to talk a little bit more about your trajectory and different influences and things you're up to, but I think I'll pass it over to you now.
All right. Well, thank you very much, John. So I'm Michael Koohafkan, and today I'm going to talk to you about habitat assessment in bar-built systems, and I'll talk a little bit more about what precisely I mean by that. And as John said, this is, part ecological analysis, part sediment analysis, and part method development. John gave a pretty good introduction, so I won't belabor the point here. Just to say, I've had a longer academic career. And again, during this, all of my academic career, actually, I have always worked. Maybe I'm a masochist or a sucker for punishment, but I've worked as a consultant during my undergrad. I worked for the San Francisco Public Utilities Commission while I was doing my master's. And then during my PhD, I worked with the Army Corps, the Hydrologic Engineering Center office, actually right here in Davis. And now I'm with the California Department of Water Resources doing work in the San Francisco Bay. So kind of a roundabout route, but coming back to the salty water, like John said. I do also want to take a minute to talk about diversity, equity, and inclusion. And so this is something that the seminar committee at the Bodega Marine Lab have asked to do, and I support this effort, this bottom-up effort to ask speakers to talk about how their work is interwoven with diversity, equity, inclusion, and kind of just foster discussions on how to make science more just. However, I refuse to make any contrived examples for how my research has, in itself, you know, a real impact on diversity or equity. You know, my research has not been in the area of social science. And so rather than try to, you know, make up some silly example about CEQA or NEPA or something like that, I'd really rather like to talk about diversity and equity in our government institutions, and specifically in the California state government. And we really can't have this conversation without first talking about how we got here. And one of the really important kind of legal things that happened in California was Proposition 209 in 1996. This was known as the California Civil Rights Initiative, and it ended affirmative action in California government, public contracting, and public education. So kind of interesting how these ballot initiatives, the way they title themselves versus what they actually mean. And I know there's a whole lot of discussion, right, about affirmative action. It's got a lot of vocal support and a lot of vocal detractors. And, you know, very recently, this really, you know, landmark paper came out. I mean, this is August 2020, right? So very recent. Looking at the long-term impact of the passing of Proposition 209 on outcomes of underrepresented communities, underrepresented minorities, all the way from their entrance into universities, and then, you know, how that translates to their wage outcomes in the future. So I highly recommend checking out this paper. It really is first of its kind in terms of being a really, really comprehensive review of the impacts or non-impacts of affirmative action. But it's super, super dense as well. You know, a lot of the work is kind of beyond me in terms of understanding those statistical analyses. And so if you're like me, you'll probably benefit more from this New York Times article that gives a really interesting summary and discussion of this paper. But the findings, you know, to boil it down to a single sentence, the findings of the paper are that ending racial preferences in a state university system negatively impacted primarily Black and Hispanic students, but there was no, you know, similar positive impacts on white and Asian American student populations. And so, you know, while it did harm to some underrepresented communities, it didn't do really any benefit to the non-minority communities. And I say that this paper is really timely because there's a new ballot, a new proposition on this year's ballot, Proposition 16. And this proposition will essentially repeal the provisions in Prop 209 and allow public agencies, public universities to consider demographics in choosing their applicants and that sort of thing. And so all I can say is vote. In the meantime, the state government has been doing quite a bit of work in the area of diversity and equity. And kind of one of the newer initiatives is CCOR, the Capital Collaboration on Race and Equity. And this is sort of a continuation of a previous initiative, which was the 2018-2019 Government Alliance for Race and Equity. But this is basically a group of representatives from all across the state, all different state agencies, coming together to talk about race and equity in our government institutions. And so DWR is a part of this effort. So I'm gonna be a little DWR centric because that's who I work for. So DWR is part of this initiative. We have about 15 representatives out of a total of about 200 representatives from across state government. And DWR is enacting its own new diversity and inclusion policies. You know, some of this might be considered lip service, but it is a real start. And I do want to say that it's a lot more than I've seen any other institution that I've worked for do. And what I think is really interesting and worth talking about, though, is that DWR is really focusing on the problem of unconscious bias. So this idea that all of us have innate biases, you know, even if we don't consider ourselves racist or prejudiced, even if we try to consciously be inclusive and that sort of thing, there are underlying biases in our psyches that are just not really possible to train ourselves out of. And so the only way to combat that at an institutional level is to implement systemic changes in how we do business. And DWR is really focusing on recruitment practices and how to remove unconscious bias in recruitment practices. And this is all really early stages, but the agency has made some concrete changes to how we send out applications and that sort of thing. And so in the past, DWR collected demographic information, you know, partly just for reporting on the agency demographics, but they made this information available to hiring managers too, even though by Prop 209 standards, they technically couldn't use that information, right, as part of the hiring process. And so we no longer give that information to hiring managers. No demographic information is provided. Similarly, no previous salary information is provided because you can often make connections between, you know, salary ranges and, you know, whether or not that person's more or less likely to actually be in an underrepresented minority community. Similarly, we're actually removing questions about bilingual and multilingual skills because, you know, while those are valuable skills and sometimes are you know, quite valuable or necessary for the job, again, a hiring manager can make inferences about your demographic background based on those skills. And so we're considering taking those off of the application as well. And maybe even going so far as to remove names from applications, you know, really just take all of the, as much personally identifying information as possible out of the application so that hiring managers really can only assess the skill sets. And then another area that is actually being looked at is the entire classification system. So the exam system for California state jobs, you go on the CalCareers website and you have to take these online exams or paper exams. It's very rigid. And, you know, these systems are on the one hand kind of designed to be equitable, right? The idea is that you have computer algorithms or that sort of thing that are supposed to judge an applicant based on, you know, objective decisions. But if you've done any of the research into, you know, artificial intelligence or just kind of how these systems work, you know that even in these engineered systems, we can engineer unconscious bias into them. And then on top of that, you know, just based on how we advertise jobs and that sort of thing, those can be limiting issues and they can really discourage underrepresented minorities from even applying for jobs in the first place. And so a lot of that stuff is being explored. And this is really early stages, but it is an actual concrete effort that's being made. And I will say that DWR really needs to make this effort because we are really lagging behind in terms of diversity of DWR's workforce, even compared to the statewide agency demographics. So even more so than other state agencies, or really the combination of all state agencies, DWR is even more predominantly men, more predominantly white than other agencies. And so we specifically have extra work to do to generate a more diverse workforce. And that is actually, there's some good news, if you think about it, is that there's really amazing change that's happening in EWR, which has kind of nothing to do with the political climate, but just a generational issue, which is that we have a massive number of employees that are expected to retire in the next 4 years, 4 or 5 years. So, you know, I've heard different numbers around, but it really does sound like somewhere between 40 to 50% of DWR is reaching retirement age in the next 4 years. So there's a real opportunity for massive turnover, really significant change in the diversity and makeup of our workforce, which by doing that will of course change the culture of the agency as well. And that's not just DWR, it's statewide that we're seeing this, what's called the, it's jokingly called the gray tsunami. And so for those of you who are interested in state government, and you know, I encourage you to be thinking about the California state government as a place where A, you're gonna be probably seeing a lot of opportunities for jobs in the future, especially for scientists and engineers. But also as a rapidly changing environment where your voice might actually be heard and you could actually make some concrete changes. And so I would love to keep talking about this stuff. I think it's super interesting. I think there's a great dialogue to be had, but instead I'm going to fulfill my degree requirements by talking to you about my research. And so I'm gonna be talking to you about two different systems, as John said. So one of these systems is the Russian River Estuary, which, you know, most of you probably at CMSI and the Bodega Marine Lab are familiar with. And I'll talk about that in the context of juvenile salmonid habitat. But I'm also gonna be talking about Midwestern rivers, specifically the Missouri River, and in the context of nesting habitat for birds, most specifically least tern. And I'm actually gonna start with the Missouri River, just because it kind of makes more chronological sense. So this presentation is a little bit stream of consciousness. It's a little bit, you know, telling you how I got here. And so just kind of a quick geographic reference, Missouri River, longest river in North America, you know, runs about 3,700 kilometers before joining the Mississippi River just north of St. Louis, Missouri. It drains a massive, massive watershed, you know, 1.3 million kilometers. And when combined with the lower Mississippi River, it's the world's fourth longest river system. And this used to be, the historic river, I should say, was a really dynamic system. You know, it's a massive sand bed river. It was a dynamic braided river system, frequently flooded, really high turbidity, and, you know, mid-channel and bank landforms were constantly being created and modified and removed by these flood events. Now the river has the largest reservoir complex by volume in the United States. Most of it situated in the middle third of the reach. And so the five largest Missouri rivers, I don't think I'm being a dam apologist when I say that these reservoirs have averted a lot of damage from floods. They've generated a lot of energy because they are some of them are hydropower dams. So they've generated about 9.3 million megawatts of energy annually. And they have significantly altered the disturbance regime of the river because, as you're probably aware, dams are really good at trapping sediment. And so when you're thinking about the species that occupy these systems, and again, my kind of main context here is the interior least tern population, which is an endangered, that population is endangered and protected under the Endangered Species Act. This modification of the disturbance regime has had a really major impact on how sandbars in the river build and how they're maintained. And the Corps was found that their operations were jeopardizing nesting habitat, sandbar habitat for least tern. And they were required to do something about it. And so as part of that effort, which is kind of largely known as the Missouri River Recovery Program, a satellite monitoring program was initiated. And so this program ran for about 10 years from, so I think 2005 to 2015, 2016, capturing very high resolution imagery of sandbars, really for the purposes of looking at least tern nesting habitat. And so it's a pretty sophisticated system with, you know, geographic image-based analysis, and I'm not really gonna go into it. You can read the papers instead. But one really interesting thing that happened here is that smack in the middle of this monitoring program, the Missouri River experienced, at least at that time, the largest recorded, I think the largest recorded event, yeah. So it was actually 20% more runoff compared to the next largest flood event. Now, of course, I believe the 2019 flood has surpassed that. But this was sort of an opportunity for the monitoring program, because now suddenly we had this natural experiment happening right in the middle of this program, and we could start asking questions about how high flows build bars. How did these massive flood events reconfigure the reach? And so I was brought onto this project probably about a year into my dissertation. And my focus was on Gavin's Reach, which is kind of one of the last semi-natural meandering channels along the Missouri River. Other sections of the Missouri River are much more engineered. And my role in this, to start with, was to develop maps of emergent sandbar habitat. And so, sort of like the picture seen here, I had a collection of images from that monitoring program, and I was tasked with splicing them together to the best of my abilities to make a map of emergent sandbars and kind of get overall reach scale estimates of habitat availability. And you can do this. It's fine. You have to be careful, right, to match images up. There was no flow control, so we were having to make decisions about which image to use for which section and which images kind of were the most similar in terms of flow and stage in the reach to get as good an estimate, a good consistent estimate, I should say, of emergent sandbar habitat in the reach. And we got it done, but I found the process really frustrating because we ended up having to toss out a ton of information, right? Because you'd have these images and they'd be overlapping at different ways, and you just kind of had to choose the best option that you had to get this reach scale estimate. But then you're tossing out information that, there's nothing wrong with the image. It's not bad data. It's just you're making a decision on what to use because you're trying to get just this one number of habitat area at the reach scale. What I really wanted to do, what I was interested in, was saying, okay, well, why can't we look at it at the individual landform level? Why can't we see how individual sandbars change through time? Why can't we generate, instead of a single map or a few maps of emergent sandbar for the whole reach, why can't we just generate time series of these individual features? And, you can do that. You can do that by hand. You can use your expert judgment to do it. It's painstaking, it's boring, but it works. Very hard to repeat. And really, really hard to do when you've got lots of partially overlapping images, right? Where you want to maybe get all that information and then try now applying that to 100 kilometers of river, hundreds and hundreds of these sandbars. Even with an army of undergraduates, you're not going to have a good time. And so I really thought about trying to automate this process, because the logic behind making these connections should be pretty simple. And I started out kind of wanting to use graph theory. It just kind of, like, as I thought about this problem, I felt that graph theory was actually going to be the solution. Graph theory was something I'd come across during my master's program, actually. I never ended up using it, but I'd read about it in the context of looking at atmospheric teleconnections. But I was drawn to it because graph theory is a formal language of relationships. It takes a system, whatever that system is, it could be a social network, it could be a landscape, whatever, and it represents it as discrete objects or nodes, and then a relationship, whatever that means, whatever that you define a relationship as, is represented as an edge connecting those two nodes. And so if you use this formal language, you have this whole data structure and this whole branch of mathematics that's available for representing graph data structures, and also for traversing and manipulating these structures. And so I thought, well, can we use this to represent the evolution of landscapes over time? And so I I'm going to go through a couple of pictures. I'm probably going to call these sandbars, but again, these could be patches, they could be any kind of feature. But consider you have two images, so the same system at two different times. And if you do a spatial union, you can see, which features in the first image overlap with the features in the second image, right? This is just a very simple GIS operation that you can do. But if you draw those connections, the output of a spatial union really can be interpreted as a graph. And so if you consider all of the features in the time one image and all of the features in time two image, each one of those delineated features is a node. And then if they overlap in the spatial union, you draw an edge between them. And that's your graph. And if you have a component, which is a set of features that kind of mutually interact, so they're not interacting with other features, but they interact with each other, you have a component, and that's sort of a self-contained little piece of the landscape, usually a single landform or maybe a collection of landforms that are interacting through time. And so when you do this spatial representation, a spatial union, you can represent that as the graph, and you can identify, you know, again, which features are part of the same component, right? And so as you can see here, the big feature on the lower right, you know, the A34 and B71, you know that A34 at time in the first image is connected to B71 in the second image, and that's your single landform through time. So once you've got these components, you just number the components and you reassign those back to your original data. And now you've turned your collection of spatial layers into a time series for each individual landform. And so using this technique, it has a lot of different implications for dealing with messy data, dealing with things like image truncation or cloud and shadow obstruction, and also identifying cases where you think a feature should exist there, but something about the environmental conditions prevent you from seeing it. So one example would be a sandbar that is flooded, that is totally inundated. And then there's all sorts of other interesting things you can do with the graph structure itself, with how you manipulate the graph to represent different things, different patterns. And that's really all I'm going to say about it in this talk, but we do have a publication out on this. We published it in 2018 to Progress in Physical Geography that goes into the details of this method. But, you know, so we wanted to apply this to think about geomorphic change in the reach. So we were interested in erosion and deposition in the Missouri River. We were interested in how individual landforms grew or consolidated or were created or were destroyed by the flood. And we were also interested in seeing how the general geomorphic trends within the river changed as a result of the flood. And so I answered these questions in two ways. So for the first one, just thinking about the flood effects, I took two images, one before the flood and one after the flood event. That had, you know, most, you know, basically complete coverage of the reach of interest and were at similar flows. And finding these two images was actually a little harder than you might expect. And, you know, I used the method to basically do, it wasn't a raster, but you can think of it as like raster differencing, right? So nothing super fancy, but the graph method did allow us to have a usable data structure for understanding individual landforms within those two and making those connections. And then for the second question, to look at the pre and post flood trend comparison, I divided the images into two sets, one before and one after. And I again used this graph approach, which I've called in the paper a progression graph approach, to develop time series of features before the event and time series of the features after the event, and look at their change in area over time to get an idea of whether or not a sandbar was eroding through time or actually growing through time or that sort of thing. And so, you know, you can kind of put it all together, right? You've got the pre-flood trajectories, you've got the post-flood trajectories, and then you have the flood response, which is kind of tying it all together to understand how these different features interacted during the flood event and kind of produced the post-flood conditions. And we found some interesting things from this analysis, you know. And so one major theme in this work was comparing, you know, what our findings are in terms of total sandbar area versus what our findings are in terms of the distribution of bars. So the number, the count of bars, and where they are. And so we found that the flood event actually, you know, significantly reduced the number of bars. It reduced the number of bars in the reach by, I think, about 150. The exact number will be in a future slide. And it shifted the halfway point in terms of the total number of bars in the reach upstream. right? And so it kind of, you could think about that as preferentially removing sandbars in the downstream area. And then we get an actually a flipped response in terms of total sandbar area. And so more area was actually created further down in the reach. And so you can see that the 50th percentile of area actually got shifted downstream, as did the 75th percentile. And the flood almost doubled the total amount of sandbar area in the reach. And looking at it a couple of different ways, we can also divide it by whether or not sandbars are bank attached or not. So mid-channel versus bank attached sandbars. And again, see how this flood changed things. And so you can see that in terms of sandbar count, the flood primarily reduced the total number of mid-channel sandbars. So again, sandbars that are not attached to the bank, but it didn't really make a huge change in the total area of mid-channel sandbars. Whereas for bank-attached sandbars, it reduced the total number a little bit, but it really grew the total amount of sandbar, bank-attached sandbar area by a lot. And then similarly on the right, we've just divided it by kind of the size class of bar. So this is a logarithmic size class, so 100 square meters, 1,000 square meters, et cetera. And you can see that the flood really shrank the number of kind of mid-size sandbars and really shifted the bulk of the area to these really larger sandbars. And we can also do the same sort of analysis looking at just the trends. And so we can see that the flood event in terms of trends, so whether or not a sandbar tended to continue growing, or you know, was growing before the flood or was growing after the flood, or whether they had higher erosive potential, that sort of thing. We can see that sandbars that tended to grow before the flood, well, the flood really reduced the total number of sandbars that are classified as gaining. Again, without really making a major change on the total sandbar area. In contrast, while it also reduced the total number of bars that were losing, the total area of those sandbars increased by quite a bit. And so in terms of sandbar area, the reach as a whole appeared to be more erosive. We had more sandbars that tended to erode than we did prior to the flood, despite that massive generation of new sandbar area. And we also looked at it in terms of transitions. So, you know, we were interested in seeing, okay, well, we've got way more bank-attached sandbar area. Is that because mid-channel sandbars, you know, ended up building to the point where they connected to the bank? And the answer is no. Interestingly enough, the mid-channel sandbars and the bank-attached sandbars, while they both responded to the flood in similar ways, right? And in both cases, you know, there was significant area growth. But they didn't transition much, right? And so if you see the dotted outlines are the places where a mid-channel bar maybe became a bank-attached bar, or a bank-attached bar was separated from the channel. And you see that almost none of that happened. And so the mid-channel bar sandbars and the bank-attached sandbars, they really seem to respond independently to the flood. And there wasn't a whole lot of interaction between these two classes. And kind of to wrap it up, I'm not going to go too much into this, but we did want to put this in the context of some of the conceptual models that managers have been using to understand bar building strategies. And so there's been a lot of work actually in the Grand Canyon trying to manage reservoir releases to build bars, I think largely for recreational opportunities. And you know, there's been some consideration of whether or not a similar strategy could be used on the Missouri River. And so we took a look at this curve and this hypothesized post-flood shift in the curve. And so the idea with this conceptual model is that at low to moderate frequency flows, sandbars are more likely to erode. In general, those flows will erode sandbars. And you have to get up to a certain flow in order to actually start depositing sand and start building these bars. And the hypothesis is that after a major flood, those low to moderate flows actually have higher erosive potential. And that depositional threshold, that flow threshold that you need to reach in order to switch to that depositional regime, gets pushed farther out. And so we just took this conceptual model and we looked at it in the context of changes in the population of sandbars. And so we, in our paper that we're hoping to publish this year, we hypothesized that This post-flood shift is partly due to consolidation of bars, basically larger bars with a larger perimeter. There's more perimeter interacting with the flow, and thus there's more erosive potential. So you might expect these bars to erode more readily than smaller bars. And then, you know, on the other hand, with these high magnitude flood events, sandbars get built can be built up to basically about as high as the water surface can get. And then at the same time, these large flows, they're going to scour the channel, and they're potentially going to cause bank failure and widen the reach. And so a combination of building sandbars to higher elevations while also widening the reach and scouring the reach and basically changing that flow stage relationship means that threshold for inundating bars, which is required to build bars, gets pushed out farther. You need a higher flow to inundate those bars. And the reconfiguration of the landscape in terms of bank-attached versus mid-channel bars also has implications for habitat, for least turn, which use these bars for nesting, and the baby terns, you know, before they can fly away, they're kind of stuck on these sandbars and at risk of predation. And there's a couple of potentially negative outcomes of this reconfiguration. Is on the one hand, by consolidating all these bars, we end up with a less complex mosaic of habitat, right? We've got this nesting area is now concentrated on fewer larger bars. And when you get, and right, and so you'd expect the populations to just have to occupy those bars a little bit more densely. And when you get a concentration of a population kind of concentrated in one place, you're potentially going to increase your predation risk. It's going to attract more predators. Predators are going to have a higher predation efficiency. Similarly, by removing the number of mid-channel bars and increasing the number of bank-attached bars, it's expected, you know, it's quite likely that these terns will have no choice but to nest on the bank-attached bars. And these bank-attached bars are also at much higher risk of predation, simply because predators are much more easily able to access them. Okay, so I've talked your ear off for a good chunk of this presentation about rivers, but this is the Coastal and Marine Sciences Institute. And so most of you are probably really more interested in the Russian River and thinking about fish and that sort of thing. And so that's what I'm going to talk about next. And so this is the Russian River estuary. Again, it's north of Bodega Marine Lab near the town of Jenner. And this estuary is pretty typical of other California estuaries. The river itself has a relatively steep gradient and is classified oftentimes as a drowned river canyon, right? It's got kind of a narrow mouth. It's a river that you know, enters the ocean. It doesn't, you know, have massive expansion kind of at the outlet. And then it's also known as an intermittently closed estuary or a bar-built estuary because seasonally, when you get lower flows and, you know, kind of happening at the same time as you get higher wave action, the wave action will build a sand berm across the river mouth. And so you can see on the right, you've got open inlet conditions where water is flowing freely from the ocean into the estuary and back. And then on the left, you have closed conditions where there's a berm that's been built and that's cut off interaction with the ocean. And so this has really major implications for water quality in the estuary. Obviously, when you have open conditions, you have that free movement of ocean water. You've got tidal mixing happening in the estuary. And so you've got a lot of saltier water coming into the system. And potentially also, you know, higher productivity water seasonally as the oceans around this area are quite productive. In contrast, during the closed conditions, you've cut off again this tidal interaction, and so you develop water quality stratification. So primarily in the salinity structure, you get the formation of a freshwater lens. That's the purple, the kind of the lower salinity water. You get a freshwater lens forming across the surface of the estuary, and the salt water is trapped in the lower portions. And there's a really well-defined picnic line. And then as the closure progresses through time, you know, river flow is continuing to enter the estuary, so the estuary lagoon continues to flood, to increase, and that salty water is pushed out of the estuary. It's either mixed in with fresh water or it seeps out through the berm, because obviously the sand berm is not a, you know, it's not concrete, right? You still have some flow through that. Similarly, because you don't have this tidal mixing, you will also end up with temperature structure. And the temperature structure kind of follows the picnic line, but it's also very seasonally driven. And so during fall closures, that freshwater lens will tend to be also the coolest part of the estuary. And so here's an example of a fall 2015 closure. And you can see that freshwater, you know, the cooler water's at the top. And in contrast, in spring and summer closures, that temperature structure often is flipped. And so the warmer waters are at the surface, and the cooler water is actually trapped at the bottom. And so the University of California, Davis, the, you know, my group, the Coastal Oceanography Group, John Largier's group, has been collecting water quality transects for probably a decade at this point, I think. And so we have repeated transects that we capture at kind of 12 key locations all along the estuary. And we've collected data both during closures and during open conditions, but a primary focus has been during closures. And I originally got involved with this work largely to help out with the NOAA habitat blueprint and an effort that was happening here. So in the Russian River Estuary, the Sonoma Water Agency is mandated under a multi-agency agreement, which is known as State Water Resources Control Board, I think decision 1610, to breach the estuary when waters in the estuary reach a certain height. And that's primarily to protect, you know, low-lying property and also prevent flooding of the nearby highway. However, a 2009 biological opinion found that these breaching actions had a detrimental impact on steelhead and coho salmon, which use the estuary and particularly use the lagoon conditions in the estuary for rearing habitat. So their outcomes are improved when they can hang out in the closed estuary system for a while and grow bigger before entering the ocean. And so my work in this started out as developing a toolbox for Sonoma Water to use to explore the transect data that we had developed. So this was an application written in Shiny, which is like an R web app if you're interested or familiar with that. And again, it was just sort of developing totals for habitat of different classes, so that they could understand how closures were likely to you know, have their water quality structure change over time. And they had some options for testing what-if scenarios. You know, what if temperature was, you know, 0.2 degrees hotter? How did things look? That sort of thing. And I had a similar frustration with this work, sort of analogous frustration that I'd had with my sandbar work, which was that, okay, fine, you know, we can get these estimates of total habitat, but habitat availability does not equal utilization. So even if we've got a closure where we've got, you know, a ton of fantastic habitat available, that doesn't necessarily mean that fish in one part of the estuary have any ability to access it. And so I wanted to actually think more about utilization and connectivity of habitat. And this is, you know, not at all new in the ecological literature. And of course, you know, this is a PhD, and PhDs are supposed to be cohesive. And so I immediately, of course, turned and thought, hey, is graph theory a tool that can be helpful here? And graph theory has been used a ton for this sort of work, exactly. You'll find no shortage of papers looking at using graph theory, using networks to understand relationships between patches. You oftentimes due to adjacency, you know, so shared borders, that sort of thing, or maybe just looking at nearest neighbor distances. And so, you know, I did the same thing. It's a very simple operation, right? And you can generate a graph that represents the connectivity structure of a patch surface. But I could also do the same thing that I had done with the Missouri River work. I could think about change through time, and I could draw connections through the patches or across patches through time. And I could combine that with the spatial adjacency stuff and basically create what, for lack of a better word, I've been calling a connectivity progression graph. And so when you do that, you can actually develop a graph structure representing the entire spatial and temporal structure of a closure. And once you do that, you've got a variety of different things that you can play with in terms of graph theory to look at this stuff. This picture is not meant to be informative. It's just sort of an example of you know, the fact that the changes in the spatial and temporal structure of these closures is captured in the graph structure itself. And so you can start to play around with these things. And that was really the focus of my third chapter, was thinking about this method and if it could, you know, provide insights into understanding. And so I had, again, three questions. You know, I was curious about habitat availability and patchiness, really not just about totals, but you know, patch variability, patch relationships. And then I had this question about habitat accessibility. So how does the role of movement capacity by fish affect their overall outcomes? Are they able to, you know, if a fish is able to move farther, will it get better results? And then kind of to wrap that all up is, does that have any implications for the overall value of a closure or of maintaining a closure for longer? And so I did that. I'm going to try to skim over this because I am running a little short on time. But I looked at that using a variety of different habitat classes. So based on salinity and temperature in terms of osmoregulatory stress and thermal stress. And then I also had a few derived classes. So I also used a temperature growth curve to think about growth outcomes for juvenile salmonids. And we used a kind of a conceptual depth classes to think about prey availability and aquatic and avian predation risk for fish. And you know, one thing that's really nice about using these graph structures is that it becomes really, really, really easy to develop figures, you know, visualizations or analyses of patch transitions. So this is just a quick example of how that freshwater lens expands over time. And you can see here that, you know, virtually all of the new water, that's coming into the estuary, so all that not present, right? So as that estuary stage actually increases, all of that is the freshwater lens. You know, no surprise, it's coming from the river. But we can also see in the bottom, we see the compression of those more saline habitats. Some of that, you know, isotonic water or brackish water, marine water is also being converted into freshwater. Or it's just disappearing and being replaced by new freshwater. And then you can do the same thing with, you know, other variables, right? So this is looking at temperature. And so in spring 2013, we can see that there's a zone of you know, some impairment that is expanding as the closure progresses. And then kind of getting out at that last one, we start to see really highly stressful conditions start to form in the estuary. And then you can also look at how these effects are co-located. So, you know, here you can, it's super easy using this method to think about, well, how is freshwater co-located with growth habitat? And so you could see here in spring of 2013, most of the freshwater habitat is at the very beginning is associated with positive or marginal growth, but then by the end of the closure, virtually all of that freshwater habitat is associated with only marginal or minimal growth habitat. Whereas in contrast, in the fall 2015, that's an incorrect label, fall 2014, or really a summer, late summer 2014 closure, we see that the freshwater habitat is actually associated with very high growth habitat by the end of it. And so we can, it's using this graph structure, using this data structure, just makes it really trivial to do these sorts of analyses. But again, this is all availability, this is not usability. And so what do we do to think about habitat utilization? And I'm gonna have to skim over this really quick because we wanted to leave 10 minutes for questions. But I used the graph theory to actually develop a Markov chain model. So we can use this habitat patch representation, and by using things like the shared border fraction or that sort of thing, we can develop probabilities of transition between habitats and convert that into a Markov model. And so then, if we want to model the trajectory of a fish, and in this case I used a mostly random walk model, you can use these Markov chain approaches. And so I did that. I ran tens of thousands of simulations of fish in the estuaries under different movement conditions for a collection of 7 closures that I selected, spanning, you know, spring, summer, and fall conditions. And I took a look at how movement affected the overall outcomes of juvenile fish, assuming again this kind of random walk approach. And I did enforce some kind of behavioral choices in this, in that I modified the graph structure so that fish would never choose to enter marine habitat. So if you're a freshwater acclimated fish, you will never choose to enter marine, you know, saltwater habitat. You can enter brackish habitat or that sort of thing, but you know, you won't ever enter marine, but you can still leave. And so those sorts of changes in behavioral modifications of the patches can actually be enforced in the graph structure itself and thus enforced in the Markov model itself. But what I found, spoiler, is that movement capacity didn't really have an impact on the average performance of fish, but it did have a surprising impact on the variability, the variance of outcomes for these simulated fish. And so if you were low movement, you had, you know, if you were a low movement fish, you had a higher chance of experiencing really good growth conditions, but you also often had a higher chance of experiencing really bad growth conditions. But again, the means didn't shift that much. And I'm gonna skip over that. And so why does this really matter? Well, I cannot skip over this. So one thing I do wanna mention too though is again, that third question, you know, are longer closures better? And so the question here was, I thought, well, let's look at the growth score. And this is color coded. So you can see that the fall closures, the really late summer, early fall closures are kind of the blues. And then the spring and summer closures are the browns. And you can see that in terms of the average outcome of fish over time, the fall closures conditions often improve over time, or at least they're maintained at a pretty high conditions, right? And so that is to say is that the habitat that fish are occupying throughout the closure gets, you know, develops better growth potential or sustains better growth potential through time. Whereas for the summer and spring closures, they do not. The growth rates actually decline through time, and that's really due to thermal stress. And so that has implications for how the Sonoma County Water Agency manages the estuary. Because if their goal, so as my understanding currently is that their goal is to create a pilot channel and maintain a pilot channel. So basically this will allow some outflow of the lagoon into the estuary, into the ocean, but is the channel will be high enough that wave action probably won't close it. And so basically you can maintain lagoon conditions, but you have a steady water balance, so you don't have to worry about flooding low-lying property. But this may not be the greatest technique for those spring and summer closures, because as you leave these closures, you know, for persisting for longer, you start developing very unfavorable growth habitats, very unfavorable thermal habitat. And just as a kind of a final thing, if you look at where fish start in the estuary, or really just kind of what's available to fish depending on where they started, with those summer and spring closures, there just isn't a whole lot of thermal refugia, refugia available. They don't have a whole ton of options, and whether or not they can move a lot or move a little doesn't really change their outcomes. And conditions only get worse as you go further upstream. And I am a little over time, so I'm just going to say thank you very much, and I will take any questions.
Thanks, Michael. That is great. Yeah. Well, you've been working this for years, right? So trying to squeeze it into an hour, or less than an hour, got a lot less than an hour, is quite a challenge. So I'm not going to talk at all. There are a few questions here that people are posing. The first one is from Rodolfo Milito, who's basically asking about, you know, the destruction, creation and destruction of patches. So in classical graph theory, you start with a fixed number of nodes. And how do you capture the dynamics of node creation and destruction? I think, Rodolfo, hopefully I'm capturing that reasonably well.
Okay. So the idea with creation and destruction is if you're thinking about it over time, any patch at any given time has its own node. So, you know, or if you think about it in the sandbar that isn't being created or destroyed, just a sandbar that persists, it's going to have a node at time one and a node at time two. And that edge between those is just kind of identifying to you in the graph structure that is kind of the next observation of that node. And so when you talk about creation or destruction, you'll see that you'll have a temporal, like there won't be another step after, right? So that node will kind of have a final occurrence in the graph and it won't occur again. There won't be another node that is connected to. So, you know, basically it'll be a sink in your graph. There's a few other options that you have for basically filling in missing data. So one thing that I did with the sandbars was I wanted to know if in one image, if I didn't see a sandbar, was that because the sandbar had been destroyed? Or was that just because it was inundated and I couldn't see it, it was underwater? And so I was able to use this technique to do that and draw connections and basically jump over that missing spot, that spot where it was flooded, and say, oh, well, I don't see it in, you know, I see the sandbar in picture A, I don't see it in picture B, but I can see it's in picture C. And so then you can actually really easily go back to your time series data and basically add in an empty observation, what I call in the first paper, a virtual observation. So yes, the sandbar exists, but under these current conditions, it has zero area.
Okay, thanks, Michael. And next question is, let's take one from Matt Brennan. Matt's asking, can you clarify about the early season closures having decreasing habitat score as compared to late season closures? Is the loss of early season due to thermal stress because the inflow was higher temperature or because of connectivity mobility of fish to move because of physiological salt tolerance changes?
Yeah, so it is, so I wasn't, so to be fair, I was not modeling physiological salt tolerance changes in this. More, I considered different classes of fish. And I think in all the figures I showed you, I was only considering the freshwater acclimated. But no, to answer your question, it really is due to thermal stratification and just kind of general heating. And so the problem, the difficulty with those spring and summer closures is that, you know, because the fish, you know, the freshwater acclimated fish can't access for any, you know, significant length of time, in my models for no length of time, the saltier marine habitat, but that is where those cooler temperatures exist. Where, right, because it's the surface layer in the spring and summer closures, the freshwater lens, which is the warmer part. And so that's why you see that decrease in the growth score. I should also point out that the score was an integer score. So I'd mentioned that I had some classes. And so to make some of the analysis a little bit easier, I would convert that to a numeric integer. And so like a 3 meant really, you know, the best class of habitat, a 2 meant the you know, second best, and et cetera. And so I looked at growth, I looked at temperature, but there were also, you know, prey and predation that I didn't show you in this presentation. And you can combine those and look at that, all that too. So there's a lot more to talk about, and I'd be happy to talk about you with it more.
Yeah, we will. Thanks, Michael. Great. So the next one, Ted Summers asking, any conceptual similarities between your Russian River fish habitat work and your Sassoon Marsh work, where freshwater and brackish inputs can be managed with operable gates?
Oh, interesting. Yeah. So So I should mention, I've been with DWR, I've been doing a lot of work with the Delta Smelt Resiliency Strategy and managed flow actions in the Sassoon Marsh. And so the work behind that has been to direct pulses of fresh water into the Sassoon Marsh using a really novel facility, you know, basically a state water project mitigation facility in a sense, but now it's being used for improving habitat by directing fresh water into the marsh and preventing saltwater intrusion. Are there similarities? I think there could be, but I must say that for the Russian River work, I really focused on the closed lagoon conditions. I did not spend a whole lot of time looking at the open tidal conditions. But there's certainly similarities in that we're trying to create freshwater habitat. And I think in the Delta Smelt strategy, we also had a similar concern regarding temperature, which was how can we be sure that we're creating habitat that is good in terms of salt preferences or salt tolerances, but isn't, you know, also creating thermally stressful habitat. And so I think that's similar stuff. I do think that there are some similarities in terms of just asking those sorts of questions. But the mechanics are different too.
Right. And also what you've talked about before is, yeah, the patches, there can be barriers between them. I mean, that's the essence of this patch connection. So you can create lots of great habitat, but unless they can get from one to the other. But let's jump back to the sandbars briefly. We're gonna run over about a couple of minutes or so here. Nicholas Pinter's asking, pointing out your graph theory and analysis documents the growth, erosion, consolidation of sandbars. But what are the processes during the 2011 flood, or in general, what processes drive these changes?
Mm-hmm. So there's a whole lot of literature on the processes, and you know, some of the older stuff really goes back to thinking about using kinematic wave theory as a way to understand how sandbars build. And so basically like a traffic jam, right? You think about, you know, as you get higher and higher concentrations, you get essentially choke points that cause, you know, the traffic jam analogy, you get a buildup of cars in one spot, and it just kind of all clumps together, and you can't, you just don't have capacity for transport once you cross a certain threshold of total number of cars on the road. And so that was sort of like the earlier ideas of thinking about sandbar building. With the Grand Canyon experiments, a lot of it has focused on the 3D hydraulic structure. So thinking about things like lateral eddies and flow expansion zones. So as you get an area of really high velocity water going through maybe a narrower channel, and then suddenly it opens up into a wider area. And so when that happens, the water slows down, obviously. You get the formation of these lateral eddies that are transporting sediment more to the channel margins, and you can build sandbars that way. Unfortunately, you know, the data that I had, you know, I did not have hydraulic data. I had top-down satellite images. We did not have any hydraulic models that we really felt were suitable for doing this work. And so we didn't feel comfortable making too many claims about process. We were more focused on thinking about, you know, just documenting what happened, and making, you know, drawing some hypotheses about these conceptual models that have been used for managed flows for building bars.
Yeah, I'm looking at the time. I really would like to carry on here a bit, but our time is up. So I think we'll end the seminar and congratulate Michael, not only in a great seminar, but being an exit seminar. Still going to submit the thesis. That's coming soon. But it's been, you know, a pleasure having you in the research group and at Davis, and wonderful seeing the work you're doing now at the Department of Water Resources. So a big virtual round of applause from everybody. You can hear it, right?
Sure.
Cheering and singing, and they're raising a glass to you as well. Strange to graduate during this COVID times. There are a couple more questions. There's one from Matt Brennan about erosion and tributaries contribution and so on. I'm going to have to leave that, but I know the two of you can find each other.
Sure.
And so with that, I close the seminar and thank you. And yeah, feel free to send your congratulations to Michael separately, of course, that you'd love to get that. Okay, that's it.
All right, thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everybody, for participating. Thank you, Michael.